Song.
No more. sing it one more time. Say I am free.
Praise the Lord, I'm free.
I'm no longer bound. There's no more chains.
No more chains holding me.
See, my soul is resting. It's such a blessing.
It's such a blessing.
Oh, praise.
Praise, you're the name above all names. Exalted.
Let's sing it one more time. Died for us, nobody else rose for us, nobody else saves us, nobody else heals us, nobody else delivers us, it's only Jesus, it's only Jesus. Oh, we lift up your name, of Jesus. You rose with all power in your hand, and it's still in your hand. God, we thank you. We could never repay you for your willingness to go and die the death that you did, Jesus, and to rise, God, so that we could be right with our Father and reign as co-heirs with Christ. There is nothing better than what Jesus has done for us. Nobody will ever give you a better gift than what Jesus has given to you. I am telling you, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard what the Lord plans to do, and he can do all of it because Jesus rose from the dead. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we honor you today, and we love you, God. Be glorified. Hallelujah. Somebody lift up a shout of praise to your King. He is so good. Amen. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us. You may return to your seats.
Happy Resurrection Sunday. Come on, let me hear one. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Come on, as a bunch of believers, this is our Super Bowl. This is the time that Christ raised and all power in his hand, and we get to celebrate the resurrection power of God, and it lives here, it lives in him, and it lives in you. Amen? Come on. Well, I'm so glad you made it here to Faith Christian Center. My name is Pastor Joey. I'm the executive pastor here at Faith Christian Center. Yeah, we're so grateful that you guys came here. You know, we know you could have went anywhere in the valley, but you decided to come here. And because of that, we're super grateful. Well, you know, I know, you know, that there's a lot of first-time guests. So if you're a first-time guest, this is your first time here, thank you, first of all, for making this a visit. We would love to connect with you. We want to be able to connect with you in some way. So in the seat pocket in front of you, you'll see this connect card, right? It's in front of you. We'd love for you to fill that out. And after service, there's a first-time guest tent as you exit to my left and your right. As you exit, we want to give you a gift in there. If you've already stopped by there today and you already received your gift, thank you for showing up. But we'd want to follow up with you the rest of the week. So what we're going to do is, with that information, we want to connect with you and find out how our family at Faith Christian Center can better serve your family and see how we can connect that way. Amen? What is a beautiful time in the service, because I believe it's important to be able to fellowship, to know who you're worshiping next to. So I want all of you guys just to stand to your feet, find somebody that you don't know, find somebody to greet, and tell them you're glad that they made it to Resurrection Sunday. Amen. Well, first-time guest, just if you haven't known this, found this out already, every time you come to Faith Christian Center, you're always going to be greeted with, we hope that you feel love today, amen? Well, it's offering time in the house. Come on. Give a little nudge to your neighbor and say it's time for extend our worship experience by giving on to the Lord, amen? Well, in this point, you can see on the screen back in front of me, there are so many ways to give. And you know what? If you want to fill out an envelope, those are in the seat pocket in front of you. And if you're giving by check or cash today, you can put that in that envelope. And as you exit the sanctuary, there are giving boxes when you leave. But as you do that, here at Faith Christian Center, we believe in giving three ways. Number one, we believe in giving intentionally. Everyone say intentionally. That means that you decided to give, you've made a plan for your giving, and you execute that plan on a regular basis. We also believe in giving regularly. Everyone say regularly. That means that we make a practice of being consistent with the decision that we made initially. Amen? And then lastly, sacrificially. Say sacrificially. That means there's moments that God has you go above and beyond your tithes and offerings and say, hey, I feel impressed on my heart to give a little extra. Sometimes that place goes to different directions, and that's what I want to share with you today. It's that sacrificial giving that makes it an opportunity for us to do amazing things at Faith Christian Center. You know, Pastor Sean talks about this. If you stick around, it's your first time, you might never heard this before, but all of you guys, we save 10% of what comes in the year, and we give it away out to the community. We bless areas. We take care of the community, the schools. Man, we do outrageous giving here, and that's because of your sacrificial giving. Amen? Well, yesterday, I stopped by a store to grab some things for the church. And they're like, man, what are you buying all this stuff for? I said, well, you know, we're doing it. We like to buy stuff for the church. We have, you know, it's Resurrection Sunday. And they had a bad experience about churches asking for money. And so I decided to tell them a story about what we do during Generosity Week. The lady was in tears. She said, I didn't know that churches executed that kind of generosity with the things that they were given. And that person had a bad experience with church. And all of a sudden, they heard one testimony, and it turned their world around. That's how your giving is extended. I believe you've done everything you need to do, so I want to just pray for our offering today. Will you join me? Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to give into your house today and to your kingdom. We believe that between every dollar, there's a soul attached to it. We thank you, God, that you've sent us on a mission here at Faith Christian Center to touch Phoenix and all the cities surrounding. And God, we want them to hear the gospel until the day that you come. So God, we put a mission on every dollar. And we thank you in advance that what we give is pressed down, shaken together, and running over. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Thank you so much for your giving.
Join us for FCC's first church-wide event of the year. On Sunday, April 21st, we're headed to the movies for early access to the upcoming film, Unsung Hero. This inspiring film, based on a true story, is family-friendly. Tickets are available now for purchase on the church website. FCC will provide a free drink and popcorn voucher for each individual who attends. Make sure to register by Sunday, April 14th. For event details, please visit the church website under calendar. Calling all students from grades 6 through 12. The Degree Youth is hosting Fahrenheit Fun Night on Friday, April 5th from 7 to 11:30 p.m. at FCC. Enjoy food, fun and games, karaoke, prizes and more. This event is free and registration is required. Please register by today on the church website under calendar. Water baptism season is back. The first baptism will take place next Sunday, April 7th. If you are interested in being baptized and are 7 years of age or older, make sure to register on the website by the end of today. Thank you for joining us in this worship experience.
Life is full of surprises.
Some good, some not so good.
And as women, we're expected to roll with life's punches and bounce back really quickly. But what happens when all the punches that are being...
taunts us in our mind, telling us, you don't have what it takes. You deserve everything you're going through right now. But this is not true. I would love the opportunity to remind you of just how capable, special, and powerful you really are. Join me on April 12th and 13th to rediscover your God-given rights, privileges, and identity. I'm calling all of God's daughters to gather together and rekindle the flame inside of you. Will you accept the call? It's time that we rise up and take our rightful place as God's daughters. Register today. I'll see you there.
No other king could vanquish the war horse. or silence the warrior's rage while riding the lowly back of a donkey. No other king could break the dominion of darkness, the tyranny of evil, with a reign of grace and a kingdom of peace. No other king could give his life for the redemption of rebels, his wealth to welcome the outcast. Jesus is that king, the king of glory, son of the living God. Not just another king, not just another prophet, not just another teacher. He was the one the world had been waiting for. The one to deliver us from captivity, the son of David and Abraham's chosen seed. He is the goal of the Mosaic law, Yahweh in the flesh. He is the one to establish God's reign and rule, to heal the sick, give sight to the blind, freedom to the prisoners, and proclaim good news to the poor. This Jesus was the creator come to earth and the beginning of a new creation. He embodied the covenant, fulfilled the commandments, and reversed the curse. This Jesus is the Christ that God spoke of to the serpent, the one prefigured to Noah in the flood, the one promised to Abraham, the one guaranteed to Moses before he died, the one promised to David during his reign, the one revealed to Isaiah as a suffering servant, the one predicted through the prophets and prepared for through John the Baptist. He is the Father's Son, Savior of the world, and substitute for our sins. More loving, more holy, and more wonderfully terrifying than we ever thought possible. He is our Jesus, and there is no other king like him. He is our God, our glory, our victorious Savior. There is no other king like him. There is no other king.
Will lay down his life for a friend.
in the love of Jesus. He hung his head, yes he did.
Ourselves about why we call ourselves Christians. I mean, there is no Christian unless there was first a Christ who was willing to come and lay down his life so that you and I can be saved. So let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Let's get right into the story today. Father, we thank you so much for the honor and privilege of being able to come boldly to your throne, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And God, as we come in faith, we come trusting and believing that both your grace and your mercy has been made available for us. Father, I count it an honor and a privilege to be here today, to stand in this pulpit, to be tasked with the honor and privilege of being able to tell your story, to talk about what you did and how you have placed us in the position that we are in today. Holy Spirit, I pray that you will speak through these lips of clay, your word with power, with revelation, with understanding, with accuracy, in a way that we can get it. You were there when Jesus went through his process. You were there when he was nailed to the cross. You were there when he was resurrected from the dead. So we thank you that you are the Spirit of truth who is here to breathe new life into the truth that we are being exposed to today. And we thank you, Lord, that everyone will leave out of here changed, leave out of here different, leave out of here transformed because of the encounter and the experience that we've had with you this morning. I covenant with you in advance to give you and you alone all the glory, honor, and praise for all that happens in this place in Jesus' name. And everybody in agreement today said,
amen.
Amen. You can be seated. Well, we're going to start today in Matthew chapter 28. And I'm going to read verses 1 through 10 from the Message translation. We'll kind of flip it a little bit. Usually you wait to tell what happened at the end, on the third day, at the end of the message. But we're actually going to talk about it at the very beginning of the message and then get into the rest of what we're going to share and discuss today. So Matthew chapter 28, beginning at verse 1, it says, after the Sabbath, as the first light of the new week dawned, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to keep vigil at the tomb. Suddenly the earth reeled and rocked under their feet as God's angel came down from heaven, came right up to where they were standing, rolled back the stone, and then sat on it. Shafts of lightning blazed from him. His garment shimmered snow white. The guards at the tomb were scared to death. They were so frightened that they couldn't move. Verse 5, the angel spoke to the women, there is nothing to fear here. I know you're looking for Jesus, the one they nailed to the cross. He's not here. He was raised just as he said. Come and look at the place where he was placed. Verse 7, now get on your way quickly and tell his disciples he is risen from the dead. He's gone on ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. That's the message. The women, deep in wonder and full of joy, lost no time in leaving the tomb. They ran to tell the disciples, and Jesus met them, stopped them in their tracks. Good morning, he said. They fell to their knees, embraced his feet, worshiped him. Jesus said, you're holding on to me for dear life. Don't be frightened like that. Go tell my brothers that they are to go to Galilee and that I will meet them there. So we're going to continue in the series started last week entitled Accept It. Accept It. And, you know, as I was going back over this story, and again, it never gets old because this is how we started. You know, there is no Christian movement throughout the world if, first of all, Christ is not willing to come, live his life, pay the price, lay down his life so that you and I could have life. And so I want to just imagine, and when I read the Bible, I like to put myself in the story. You know, I want to feel what they felt. I want to experience what they experienced. And as I was reading the story, I was just asking myself, I can only imagine what it felt like to be the first ones to receive the news that he got up. And I was telling my wife the other day, I said, man, when the angel rolled the stone and sat on it, I said, that was so beast mode. I said, That's like getting dunked on and being told you're too small. That's like getting bodied and being told that you're telling somebody you're too strong. That's like getting in a fight and realizing after you get in the fight, I might be in a little bit over my head. Just imagine the level of joy and the level of excitement that rose up on the inside of the Marys as they were tasked with the responsibility of going and telling the other disciples that he got up from the dead. And, you know, it reminds me of, you know, like Larry Bird and Michael Jordan. You know, when I would watch documentaries after they have retired, and people that would compete against them would talk about how they were so good at what they did that they would actually impose their will upon a person, and there was really nothing that the other people could do about it. Jordan would flat out tell you, I'm going to get 50 tonight, and then would come out and get 50. Larry Bird, I didn't really like Larry Bird growing up because you got to understand, I'm from Detroit, so the Pistons had to go through the Celtics, and then I was a Lakers fan. No offense to all the Phoenix Suns fans are here today, but I was a Lakers fan back in the day when Magic used to play, and so we always had to go through Bird. What I didn't know was that Bird was an even bigger jump talker than a lot of other people. Bird would flat out tell you, I'm gonna take two dribbles to the left, I'm gonna take three dribbles to the right, I'm gonna go through the legs, go up for the jumper, and there's nothing that you can do about it. So as I'm going back reading the story, I'm saying, man, that's the way that Jesus played. Jesus in Matthew 16 said, I must go to Jerusalem to suffer many things of the elders. I will be betrayed by the elders and the high priests and the scribes. I will be killed, but on the third day, I will rise again from the dead, and there is nothing that you can do about it. I want to have a little fun with this today, so just help me preach this. I mean, I'm just imagining that the angel had a little bit of soul. When he showed up there at the tomb and rolled away the stone. And so I could just kind of see the angel, you know, saying to the woman at the tomb, you're looking for Jesus. The one that they nailed to the cross. But I'm here to tell you. He ain't here. He's risen. He got up from the dead like he said he would. If you don't believe me, just go into the grave. See if you see him. I don't see him. Do you see him? Because I don't see him. Because he ain't here. If you're looking for him, he might be in Galilee. Go tell the other disciples that he got up. He got up. I said he got up. He got up. Come on and praise him. Come on and shout. Come on and rejoice. Because he got up from the grave like he said he would. Come on, this is a special time of the year for those of us that are believers in Christ. The Bible tells us the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. The testimony of what Christ did for us at Calvary is still preaching, still prophesying today. It is still resurrecting dead things, still resurrecting dead people. Come on, we are still testifying that he got up, but now we're testifying that we got up. Let me save some of my energy. I got three more services after this. No, just joking. Hebrews chapter 12 tells us that if you ever find yourself flagging in your faith, go back over that story, item by item, the long litany of details that he endured in order to get us into the position that we're in today. Study how he did it. Focus on how he was able to lock in, how he never lost sight of the finish line. And when you go back over the story, it'll shoot adrenaline into your souls. See, folks, every intricate detail of Jesus' life and ministry was the fulfillment of an Old Testament prophecy. This is a time of celebration for us today, but make no mistake about it, what Jesus endured to get us to this point was grueling. Man, what he endured the last 3.5 years of his life was more than most of us would have been able to handle over the course of a lifetime. And one of the things that he took to the cross for us was rejection. He was rejected by his creation so that we could be accepted by our Creator. And if there is anybody who can relate to those of us who have experienced rejection, it's Jesus. That's why I appreciate Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, which tells us we don't have a high priest who cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet he was without sin. In other words, we can never come to Jesus and say, you just don't understand what I'm going through. Because everything that you have experienced and everything that you are going through and challenged with in this life, Christ himself has experienced, because when he put on the body, he wasn't just God, he was man, feeling what we feel, enduring what we have to endure, feeling the limitations that we experience as human beings upon the earth. And I want you to see some of what the scripture says about what he had to endure when it comes to rejection. Look at what the scripture says. Look at Luke chapter 17, verse 25. It says, but first the Son of Man must suffer terribly and be rejected by this generation. John chapter 1, verse 11, he came to his own people and even they rejected him. Mark chapter 8, verse 31, then Jesus began to tell them that the Son of Man must suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. John chapter 6, verse 66 and 67. After this, a lot of his disciples left. Somebody say rejection. Yes. They no longer wanted to be associated with him. Then Jesus gave the 12 their chance. Do you also want to leave? Matthew chapter 13, verse 54 through 58. He returned to Nazareth, his hometown. When he taught there in the synagogue, everyone was amazed and said, where does he get this wisdom and the power to do miracles? Then they scoffed, he's just the carpenter's son. We know Mary, his mother, and his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. All his sisters live right here among us. Where did he learn all of these things. And they were deeply offended and refused to believe in him. Somebody say rejection. Then Jesus told them, a prophet is honored everywhere except in his own hometown and amongst his own family. And so he did only a few miracles there because of their unbelief. As I go through all of these verses, as I was studying this in my personal time, I was blown away by how much rejection Jesus dealt with in just a 3.5 year period. And to sum it all up, Jesus faced rejection generationally, racially, socially, professionally, locally, nationally, ministerially, and relationally. He dealt with more rejection over a 3.5 year period than most of us would have dealt with over the course of our lifetime. I want to take a moment to talk a little bit about what rejection is, because it wasn't just something that he experienced, it's something that many of us also deal with today. See, rejection hurts, but what I want you to understand is that rejection is also common. And 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 tells us that there is no temptation that has taken us but such as is common to man. For God will, with the temptation, also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. So one thing you got to understand about temptation, or the things that we deal with in this life that are common, whenever something is common, that means we should not overcomplicate it. Because, see, the more complicated you think your problem is, the more complicated you'll think your solution has to be. Whenever something is common, that means somebody else has already beaten it. And if someone else has already beaten it, then why shouldn't you beat it too? When something is common, we got to get a revelation that God is no respecter of persons. And here at this church, we believe that one person's testimony can actually become someone else's prophecy. That one individual's revelation can actually become somebody else's Genesis. That all you got to see is one other person come through it and walk in victory over it in order to lock in and say, God, what you did for somebody else, I know and I believe you are willing to do it for me too. Now, all of us want to feel a sense of belonging and acceptance with other people. But something happens on the inside of us when we feel like we are not accepted by those we deem important to us. And after experiencing rejection, the fear of rejection happening again can diminish our risk quotient, our capacity for taking risks. And when we avoid taking actions that might result in us being rejected, we might feel like we're playing it safe. But this avoidance actually comes at a cost. There are some things in life that you will never experience unless you are willing to take risks. I'm talking about relationally, spiritually, financially, professionally, et cetera, et cetera. 1 Corinthians 2 tells us there are things that our eye has not seen, things that our ear has not heard, things that haven't even entered in our heart yet, all that God has prepared for those that love him. Amen. And some of those things that our eyes haven't seen and that our ears haven't heard, we have to be willing to take risks in order to experience them. God's not going to drop everything that you're believing for and that you desire to see in your life in your lap. Some things you're going to have to walk out. Peter will never know what it's like to walk on water if he isn't willing to take a risk. David will never know what it's like to slay Goliath if he is not willing to take a risk. He would never know what it's like for God to keep him when the lion and the bear came and took a sheep out of his flock if he was not willing to take a risk. See, this life of faith that you and I have been commissioned to live sometimes feels a little bit risky. And if we aren't willing to take those risks because we're playing it safe, especially out of a fear of people rejecting us if things don't go the way that we expected, then when we decide to play things safe, we're leaving a lot on the table. Now, what scientists have discovered is that rejection and physical pain, although they appear very different on the surface, to our brains, they are very similar in experience. So it's easy to understand why people fear rejection, because in their minds, when they avoid rejection, what they're doing is avoiding pain. Now, how we process rejection has a lot to do with our past experiences, and also how we've trained ourselves to view rejection going forward. Sometimes we perceive that we are being rejected far more often than we actually are. Come on, you can tell your neighbor on the side. If you say, neighbor, sometimes it's not as bad as you think it is. Come on. Sometimes we perceive that we're being rejected. How many know there's a narrative going on in your mind? There's a story that's unfolding in your mind. Some of that story is true. Sometimes that story is not true. And sometimes we create situations and circumstances and we think we have other people figured out and we make assumptions instead of asking questions. We make assumptions instead of asking questions about what people think and feel about us and about what we do. So instead of asking how we can be better, instead of asking how to make things better, we just keep doing more and more and more of what we always have done. And sometimes that just leads to rejection, 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 rejection. Sometimes rejection happens for a reason that can be resolved if given the right information. Come on, somebody say preaching better than I'm saying amen and head of day. Now, in order to walk in victory over rejection, we have to be honest with ourselves about how rejection affects us. We need to resist the temptation to pretend like we don't care. I don't care. I don't need nobody. It's just me and God. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. God before me, who would be against me? Come on, that's your rejection talk. Telling yourself that you don't care when you experience rejection denies you the education that you need to work through it in the future. You got to resist the temptation to pretend like you don't need anybody. Yes, you do. You saying you don't need anybody isn't even biblical. The hand can't say to the foot, I don't need you. Come on, the Lord already told you that in his word. Jesus said, wherever two or three are drawn together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. When the brethren dwell together in unity, that's the place I've commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. Come on, when you want to get to that place where you're able to do the things that are beyond your imagination and restraint, you got to have somebody there at your side. Come on, if one comes against you, two will withstand you. A threefold cord is not quickly and easily broken. So don't pretend like you don't need anybody. That's just your rejection talk. Amen. And then when you go off into isolation and then you turn on your Jericho alarm system, come on, walls up, walls up. Some of you came in here today with your alarm system on. Watch this, and you think that you're protecting yourself from people who hurt you, but in all actuality, you're also keeping the people out of your life that God wants to send into your life to help you heal. You got to resist the temptation to run away or to return to your past. Listen, I'm about to speak to all my church folk in here today. There comes a point when you have to stop calling rejection a new season. I'm telling you, some of this Christianese, some of these Christian slogans that we throw out here sometime, when we don't want to address what's going on with us, and it's just easier to point the finger at everybody else. And listen to me, folks. There comes a point where you got to get tired of starting over and calling it a new season. Look, the Lord is just bringing me into a new season. No, what happens is you're dealing with rejection, and that rejection is bringing up things on the inside of you that you don't want to deal with. Come on, this side over here, nudge your neighbor and be like, they don't want to talk to him today. You got to lean into the uncomfortableness that you feel when you're rejected. Sometimes you got to learn how to stay where you are and work through that uncomfortableness until you've worked out your salvation with fear and trembling. Resist the temptation to pretend like you don't care. Resist the temptation to pretend like you don't need anybody. Resist the temptation to run away or return to your past. Your past is always going to be available. Just because it's available doesn't mean that it's appropriate and needed in your life right now. Lastly, resist the temptation to try to rejection-proof your life. Don't try to rejection-proof your life. Sometimes it's the will of God for us to experience rejection so that we can learn how to work through it. I mean, you can't always control what happens to you, but you can control how you allow it to affect you on the inside. And let's be honest, you got to leave some room in your life for Romans 8:28. Come on, you know the verse. And we know that how many things? That all things, good things and bad things, things we like and things we don't. We have to allow some space, some room for all things to work together for our good, for those that love God, and to them that are called according to his purpose. Come on, you gotta stop just labeling a tough situation, a bad situation, as one that God can't stick his hand into and work with and cause something good to come out of it. God doesn't just get glory from the easy moments in your life, the things that you enjoy, the things that are not tough, the things that don't require you to walk by faith. God gets glory from sticking his hand into a difficult situation and showing you what you can do when you just learn how to trust God. Painful moments, when they are handled properly, oftentimes lead to greater anointings and greater glory upon our lives. We're talking about rejection today. You have to figure out what frightens you about rejection. There's a boogeyman in your closet. And I know you're grown. I know you're mature. I know you say, I'm not afraid of ghosts anymore. But what about the ghost of rejection? For some of you, rejection's been hiding under your bed, hiding under your closet, hiding in your closet, meeting you when you wake up in the morning time. You have to trace the umbilical cord of rejection back to where it started. You might be dealing with it in 2024, but that's not when it started. When you figure out what's behind your fear of rejection, you can go back to that time in your life and release yourself from it. Because here you are, 40 years old, but 9-year-old you keeps showing up. You're dealing with 40-year-old's issues, but that 9-year-old kid keeps showing up saying that I got it. Throw it to me. I can do it. This will help you address it when it shows up. In 2013, I was sitting right in that seat, right there. It was my 10-year anniversary celebration, 10 years of ministry. The church was honoring me and celebrating me that day. And I was so blessed by what was going on. And when I was sitting there in the front row, the Holy Spirit said to me, the seed of rejection is deep on the inside of you from your father, and it's disguised itself as independence. I know that wasn't me because I was all into the celebration. I was like, it's like, what? The seed of rejection is deep on the inside of you from your father, and it has disguised itself as independence. I didn't realize at the time that my father not being present in my life was affecting me the way that it was. I didn't realize for so many years that I was trying to prove myself to someone that I didn't even know. Without me having a conversation with my father, through my independence, I was saying to my dad, Dad, I can do it myself. Dad, I can do it myself. Dad, I can do it myself. I thought it was strength. I thought it was faith. I thought it was independence. And the Holy Spirit said, no, that's rejection. Once I became aware of it, then I was able to deal with that little boy that kept showing up every time I tried to prove something, not to everybody else, but to prove it to myself. In Matthew chapter 27, look at this, verse 45 and 46. It says, at noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus called out with a loud voice, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you abandoned me? From the launch of Jesus' ministry until its conclusion, he faced rejection from his family, from his community, from his own people, from the multitudes, from the religious leaders, and in the very end, even from his own disciples. In Matthew chapter 27, this is so powerful. This is the first and only time we have on record of Jesus asking God why. And reading through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there hasn't been another time that I have ever seen Jesus ask God why. Now, Matthew chapter 27, verse 46 is actually an Old Testament, it's a reference from Psalm 22 and 1, which says the exact same thing. Both of them say, my God, why have you abandoned me? And this was so powerful. Jesus in this moment was not just expressing his feelings. He was actually leaning on his faith in the scriptures while experiencing for the very first time what felt like abandonment and rejection from his Father. And as I'm reading this, I'm thinking to myself, he was demonstrating to us what it means to walk by faith. When you allow the scriptures to be a guide for you through difficult moments in your life. When you lose somebody that you love and you don't just allow your emotions to be the guide, but you remind yourself that in my Father's house are many mansions. He has gone to prepare a place for me that where I am, there I may be, there he may be also. And if it were not so, he would have told me. He told me not to grieve like those that do not have hope. It's when you use the scriptures as a companion to walk you through moments you don't understand, you can't see a way out, and all you can do is trust God in the midst of it all. For the first time ever, he's wondering why. For the first time ever, he is experiencing abandonment from his Father. And instead of allowing his emotions to judge the situation, he used the scriptures to help walk him through that difficult time. Jesus called God, Father, 165 times in the Gospels. Yet here, when he experienced abandonment for the first time, he did not say, my Father, why have you abandoned me? He said, my God, why have you abandoned me? And this is so good. This is one of the most difficult moments in his life, yet he was keenly aware that what he was experiencing was not personal. See, so oftentimes we go through difficult times and we're like, Father, how can you allow something like this to happen to me? And we take personal what we're going through because we look at ourselves as a parent and we say, if as a parent, I would never allow one of my kids to go through this. But Jesus understood that God was not just Father, but he was also God. And God had a job to balance the scales of justice in order to free humanity from sin, death, hell, and also the grave. So what was happening to him wasn't his daddy doing it to him. It was his God doing what was necessary based on what he understood about the laws that he put in place here upon the earth so that he could free humanity once and for all from sin, death, hell, and also the grave. So good. So good. This was the hardest part of Jesus' human experience. Was being rejected by the Father for us. He had never committed any sin. No guile was ever found in his mouth. He had never committed a transgression. He had never done his own thing. He had never followed after his own desire. Everything that he was experiencing was for us. In Matthew 27:46, God placed the sins of the world upon his Son, and Jesus felt for the first time ever the abandonment of his Father's presence. He felt the Father's hatred for sin. He died in our place. He died on our account. He became something he never was, just so that you and I could become something we could never obtain on our own. And listen, when you become a Christian, when you ask Jesus into your heart, you are immediately and unconditionally accepted by the Father in your state. You don't have to clean anything up. You don't have to make any adjustments. You don't have to make any changes. You just come to him as you are, and you are accepted by the Father. The will of the Father is that all men and women, boys and girls, would be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. His desire is that everybody would come to him so that he can accept them and receive them into his kingdom. But in Matthew chapter 10, as I close, verse 32 and 33, it says, if you stand before others and are willing to say you believe in me, then I will tell my Father in heaven that you belong to me. But if you stand before others and say you do not believe in me, then I will tell my Father in heaven that you do not belong to me. So going back to last week, if how you are viewed by other people is more important than how you're viewed by God, then your rejection of him here will lead to your rejection when you get to heaven. But if you can accept him while you're here and confess him before men, then that will lead to your acceptance by God when you cross over to the other side. So there are one of two positions that you can take today. Number one, you can say, he accepted me. He accepted me, therefore I accept him. Say that with me. Say, he accepted me.
Therefore I accept him.
But there's another position you can take. Say this with me. Say, he accepted me. But I reject him. And that's hard to say. But the reality is that to not accept him is to reject him. So while every head is bowed and every eye is closed in prayer, Jesus bore upon himself rejection so that you and I could know what it's like to be accepted by God. If you're in this place today and you have never asked Jesus to come into your heart or to come into your life, then I believe with all of my heart, you're not here by coincidence, by accident, that God brought you here to this place today so that you would have an opportunity to receive Christ into your heart and life. If you're in here and you say, Pastor Sean, I used to know the Lord at one time, but I'm in what some people would probably call a backslidden state. I've drifted away from God, fallen away from God. And today I want to come back home. I want to recommit my life. I was encouraged by the story. Going back over the details of Jesus' life and being reminded about all the things that he did for me so that I could be saved. And I have not been living for him. I've actually been living for myself. If that's you, then I would love to pray with you. Pray for you. The third invitation I want to offer is maybe today you have lived in isolation. You've been a sheep without a shepherd, a sheep with no community. And you say, you know what, today I want to be a part of this church. I love you. If that's you, then we would love to receive you and accept you today. Invitations that were given. One, if you need to receive Christ, you say that he accepted me, therefore I accept him. Or you need to recommit your life. You say he accepted me, but I have drifted away from him. Today, I want to recommit my life. Or you say, I'm one of those sheep that don't have a place I can call home, and I want to join up with you here at Faith Christian Center. So three different invitations. If any of those three apply to you, then right where you are, ask you to raise your hand in the air if you want prayer in one of those areas that I just mentioned to receive Jesus. Go ahead and raise your hand up high so that I can see today. You want to recommit your life or you want to join up with us here at Faith Christian Center. Amen. I see you today. Amen. I see you. I see you. I see you. Praise God. I see you today. I see you. I see you. I see a hand here. I see a hand there. Glory to God. Anyone else today want prayer in one of those areas? Just raise your hand in the air. Be happy to pray with you. God, I see you. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. All right, you can put your hands down. Now, if you raised your hand on one of those invitations or you didn't, but deep down on the inside, you believe that you should have, don't miss out on this moment. Don't miss out on this time. You're not just here because it's Easter. You're here because you need to make some decisions where your relationship with Jesus is concerned. And today is your day to get it right. All right, so I'm going to pray this prayer. And as I pray it, we're going to pray it together so you don't feel alone because we're family in here today. Pray it from your heart and really mean it. And I trust and I believe that God is going to meet you right where you are today. Say this with me. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I believe your Son, Jesus Christ, died on the cross and shed his blood for my sins. I believe there is no other name under heaven given amongst men whereby I can be saved. I believe that Jesus came here to the earth, lived his life, died on the cross, went into the grave, rose on the third day, and is alive forevermore. So Jesus, I submit and surrender my life to you today. Come into my heart. Come into my life. Save me from my sins. And save me from myself. Today, you are my Lord and personal Savior. I'm your child. I'm born again. My name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and I'll never be the same. In Jesus' name. Father, I pray for those who have prayed this prayer, and I pray for those who are recommitting their lives to you today. Some people who have drifted away that are coming back home right now. And God, right now, I thank you that you're meeting them right where they are. You said that if we confess our sins, you're faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So this is what being a Christian is. You make a mistake, you don't leave God. You talk to God about the mistake that you made. You confess it. You acknowledge it. You commit that I'm going to change my thinking and amend my ways so that I don't end back up in this same situation again. Some of you have to make that decision right now. And then there are other things that are connected to that decision. Maybe some friendships, some relationships, some people that keep trying to pull you back into your old life. Make a decision today that when you surrender to God, you're also going to surrender the other decisions that need to be made so that you can grow in your faith. God, we thank you that you're cleaning people up today, removing the shame, removing the guilt. God, you don't guilt us and you don't shame us when we drift away. You receive us as a loving Father. There is grace, there is mercy that is extended, and we pray today is a new beginning, that people will never be the same in Jesus' name. Lastly, God, we pray for those who are joining up with us here at FCC. God, we pray that people find community, they build relationships, and that, God, they are strengthened as a result of what they get during their time here. We pray that they won't just be attendees who sit on the bench, but we pray, God, that they will get into the game and be used by you to bring glory and honor to your name. We give you praise and glory in Jesus' name. And everybody in agreement today said, amen. Congregation, give it up for everybody that prayed with us today. Now I'm going to ask that you do me a favor. In one of the seat pockets in your row, there should be a connect card that looks like this. If you're a first-time guest, and you probably already have one, if you stop by our first-time visitor, tent on your way in, please take a moment and fill it out. It's just a few questions that we ask. We've taken some of the information off to make it super simple for you so that it only takes you about 13 seconds to be able to complete the card. Amen. So I encourage you, if you leave out of here and you don't take the moment to fill out the card, then you can make a great decision and then leave out of here and go right back to your normal routine and forget the things that are necessary in order to grow in the decision that you made today. So we encourage you, grab one. If you're up front, you need one, just raise your hand. I'm sure one of our ushers will be happy to place one in your hand. So take a moment, fill it out. And before you leave off of this property, make sure you put this into the hands of one of our volunteers or someone at our first-time visitor tent. All right, I'm going to invite you to stand to your feet. I want to remind you that if you need prayer for anything, we have prayer. We will have some ministers down front who will be available to pray with you and for you. If you're a first-time guest and you did not stop by our first-time visitor tent on your way in, please make sure you stop by, drop off your card. We have a gift that we want to give to you. Amen, just our way of saying thank you for coming out today. Always great to see you all on Resurrection Sunday. I pray it's not just a religious thing that we do, but it is a reminder of why we call ourselves Christians. May you be stirred up on the inside today as you remember that your God is no longer in the grave, but he got up from the dead. Let's go.